Peace be with you. I am Bruce Wozniak. This is Catholic Sports Radio, located at the intersection of your faith life and sports life, and on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and lots of other platforms. Thanks so much for joining me for this and hopefully many other episodes. The show website is catholicsportsradio.net. You can listen there. There are also links there to hear the show on all kinds of podcast listening apps. And there are links on the website to Catholic Sports Radio on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can always send comments through the website. Plus, you can post thoughts, suggestions, and engage with other listeners in the show's Facebook group, which is called CSR Listeners. There's a button for that, too, on catholicsportsradio.net. Let me know what you like about the show. Any particular guests you've really enjoyed, testimonies that have really spoken to you. Most importantly, let me know how Catholic Sports Radio has helped you in your faith life. Please help me spread the word about the show. I'd be most grateful if you would tell others to listen in as well. And by the way, if this is your first time listening, thank you. And do go back and listen to previous episodes of Catholic Sports Radio. There have been a lot of great guests, a lot of really good testimony. As for my ministry moment for this episode, this past weekend I found myself sitting at my desk working on Catholic Sports Radio at 4:30 on a Saturday afternoon. The next time I glanced down into the corner of my laptop, the time showed 5:30, again on a Saturday afternoon. And in that moment, I realized that while lots of other people clearly were doing lots more recreational things at that time, I wasn't looking for a medal or a chest to pin it on. I was simply being obedient. We see flags thrown in football, we hear a whistle blow and see play get stopped in basketball and hockey. A call is being made by an official because one of the participants committed a foul, a penalty, some sort of violation. Leagues and or teams announce fines and or suspensions because, again, an athlete wasn't being obedient. There are rule books in every sport setting the guidelines that all the participants must follow. And similarly, in the New Testament, we see in Ephesians that almost the first one-third of chapter 6, specifically verses 1 to 9, talk all about obedience, starting with, "Children, obey your parents," and continuing on to also speak specifically to fathers, slaves, and masters. On those last two, by the way, referring to slaves of Christ and to a master in heaven. Friends, for the scores of us who aren't athletes, officials, or coaches and don't need to memorize the rule book, let's instead challenge ourselves to plunge deeper into the Word and study how we can be more obedient to our Heavenly Father. Moving on now with this week's episode, my guest is the Executive Senior Associate Athletics Director for External Relations at the University of San Francisco. He won 17 league championships and 2 Division I state championships in 18 years at De La Salle High School in Concord, California, and has coached and or been a speaker at basketball camps from China to Belgium to Canada. As a college athlete, he played football and basketball at Notre Dame. He is also an inductee to the Sports Faith International Hall of Fame. Welcome to Catholic Sports Radio, Frank Allocco.
Bruce, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm happy to visit with our listeners, and I appreciate all the work that you do to promote the Catholic faith.
You bet. Thank you, Frank. And amazing achievements, I must say, that I read off, and the list actually goes on. In fact, listeners, I'll put a link to Frank's website on the show page for this episode on catholicsportsradio.net. But Frank, as much as I mentioned about your having been out in California for so long, you're actually from the East Coast originally.
Yeah, I'm very proud of being a Jersey boy. You know, I was born and raised in New Jersey. I was very blessed to be raised by two people of great faith, my mother and my father. We were daily communicants from the time we were born, I think. You know, my dad was a factory worker and he would drop us off and we always went to Mass before school. My father passed away last year, but he was an amazing role model of how to live a Christ-like life. You know, he was a volunteer fireman for 67 years. He was an active fireman, 94 years old. He was president of the fire department. Wow. My mother's 91, still living back in New Providence, New Jersey, makes sandwiches every week, you know, for the church. And so we were very blessed to be in an environment with people that really lived Christ-like and modeled that for us. I went to Our Lady of Peace Grammar School in New Providence, and that was really the core of my foundation was really formed there. I loved being at that school. These lessons that we got about our faith, but also about family, you know, about living together. And we were very close to the priest, the nuns. In fact, I told the nun there one day that I would be a quarterback at Notre Dame, told her that on the playground one day. And so that was my dream. Then I headed over to New Providence High School, which was right across the playground. And my brothers had gone to Catholic school. My older brother, Jerry, went to Oratory Prep. My brother, Michael, went to Union Catholic. I did not go to Catholic school because they didn't have football. And my younger brother and I both played football. And so my dad allowed us to go to public school, but yet we were always a playground away from our roots at Our Lady of Peace.
Yeah, I wanted you to talk about starting into sports. I don't know what age that might have been, because as much as I highlighted basketball in the intro, when you were young, you were looking for a high school that had football, correct?
That's right. Yeah. I mean, we played three sports. You know, it's kind of a unique thing now, unfortunately, but we played three sports. You know, whatever the season was, we played. And yes, with a New Providence High School, had a tremendous football program. But I got to be honest, my love for football really was for Notre Dame. You know, I really always wanted to go to Notre Dame. My grandfather was a Notre Dame fan. And from the time I was a little boy, I looked up to Terry Hanratty and Jim Seymour and dreamed that one day I would do that. So my father allowing me to go there, there was a goal in mind that maybe that would lead to something bigger and better for me. So that's why my dad allowed me to make that choice.
But was the attraction to attending Notre Dame simply about sports, or were you also drawn to the faith component of the university?
Oh, no question about it. The faith component. Actually, there was three things. It was the spiritual aspect, the academic aspect, and the athletic aspect. It had such a great combination of all three. And I often say that Notre Dame, to me, the people that were there at that particular time, I wanted to learn from great people and people of faith. And Father Hesburgh was, if you look to my desk to the right, I have a huge picture of Father Hesburgh and Martin Luther King here. And I have pictures of Ara Parsegian. I mean, these guys, to be around Ara Parsegian and Father Hesburgh, Moose Krauss, there were certainly giants there. And so, yes, the faith part really drew me there. It felt like it was the right place for me.
And so, listeners, you hear a lot of adversity, don't you? And a lot of episodes of this show of some people that maybe strayed from their faith, or some people that just had huge obstacles for some reason. Haley Scott DeMaria is coming to mind. You can go back and listen to my interview with her and what she had to overcome. In the case of Frank, share with the audience, if you would, about the injuries that you suffered both in high school and in college playing football.
Yep. So I, going to New Providence High School was interesting. They had an All-American quarterback there. And I went to the high school coach and said, give me every drill you can to get me to Notre Dame. And he looked at me and said, Notre Dame, you're never going to play here. How are you going to play at Notre Dame? I said, don't worry about that. You know, it was 150 pounds, but he actually worked with me every day, you know, on my game. And unfortunately, my senior year, I had a great junior year. I was the backup quarterback for 2 years behind a guy named Bob Woodruff, who went on to play at Syracuse. He was an All-American quarterback. And I jumped in my junior year, and I had a fantastic year, broke most of his records. And so I was getting recruited by everyone, and I made preseason All-American. And then the first game of my senior year, 2 minutes into the game, I was 2 for 2, one touchdown pass already. And then I was rolling out on an option play, and I snapped my collarbone in half. Mm. And then wow. Went to Notre Dame and was a backup quarterback again for 4 years behind a guy named Tom Clements, who was an exceptional quarterback, led us to a national championship in 73. And when I got my turn, I was rolling out to throw a pass and got tackled and separated my shoulder. So both times my dreams were derailed by injuries.
But at the same time, you learned faith lessons from those injuries that you've carried with you to teach the players that you've coached over the years, yes?
Bruce, I have to be honest with you that when the injuries first, the second injury happened, it really hit me hard. I was so excited and so grateful, and I had such a great relationship with Christ, and I really always felt like I lived the right way. And there was a little sense of entitlement, almost like I deserved things because I was good. You know, when I got the opportunity to be the starting quarterback at Notre Dame, I went to church every day. Wow. And to thank God for giving me the opportunity to start and achieve my dream. I would drive to Mass and honk my horns, and I was just so happy that I finally was getting the opportunity. And then, of course, you separate your shoulder and everything goes away. And to be honest with you, I learned many, many lessons from it, but I had to, I had to really sit back and understand. It took me a long time to process what I really got out of it. Because at first, my dream was I'm going to stay and I'm going to do everything possible to try to come back. And I did. I did everything humanly possible. I worked hard. And then when, you know, September came around, my shoulder had to have a second surgery on it, which set me back a few weeks. And then, you know, I fell behind and I didn't get that opportunity to start. And to tell you the truth, I was bitter. And I questioned my faith. Mm. I really did. And I just felt like I did everything you asked of me and I didn't get my opportunity. Wow. And I felt that way. I felt that way for several months. And then a few things happened. Number one, I had made friends with a guy at Mass. I found this old man that I took under my wing. He was 85 years old. His name was Harry Davis. And it was almost like God sent him to me. You know, I was in Mass and I watched this man come in and his face was frozen with tears. And he came in late and I waited. He reminded me of my grandfather. And I went up to him and I introduced myself. And he told me that he rode his bike to Mass.
At 85 years old?
85 years old. And so we started talking and I said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll pick you up, you know, on the way to church. So I started this ritual and he and I became the best of friends. And then as the months went on, I asked him what he did after Mass.
Let me interrupt you. You were a college student.
Oh yeah.
A college student that was driving an 85-year-old man back and forth to church who you had never met.
Never met him before. And I'm telling you, then one day I asked him, I said, what do you do after Mass? He said, I ride my bike to see my wife. And I said, where's your wife? He said, she's buried in the cemetery. Ironically, the same cemetery that Newt Rockne's buried in. And I said, I'll tell you what, I don't have a class till 10 o'clock. I'll take you to this, to visit your wife. And I watched this man every day go and kneel in front of her grave and pray. And as he became more comfortable with me, I started doing it with him. And we would sit and we would clean off her grave. And he would tell me about the spring. We're going to paint flowers and we're going to plant flowers and put up a cross and all these things that we did. And I'll tell you, it was a lesson in love that I actually felt it was divine intervention that God sent me, sent him to me to teach me how to love, because I still think of the way that man loved his wife, you know.
Were you telling him as you were getting to know him, were you telling him who you were, that I'm the quarterback of Notre Dame?
You know, it's amazing you asked that question. For all you listeners, Bruce is good because we've never discussed that particular story. The amazing thing about that is I never told him that. And that was so interesting because everybody, you know, at that time I was the quarterback in Notre Dame. I got to present a football to President Ford. You know, I was sort of a celebrity and I never told him. Our relationship was only based on our friendship at church. And interestingly enough, he actually showed me where Newt Rockne's grave was. He had helped to build Newt Rockne's home. And when I went in for my surgery, the priest came in to bless me. And he looked at me and he said, you're Harry Davis's friend. He says, does he know you're the quarterback? I said, no, I never told him that.
But what's impressive about that, too, is that you just finished saying that you found yourself walking around with a little bit of entitlement. And yet, for some reason, Holy Spirit, for some reason, you opted never to tell this old man who you, quote, I'm holding up air quotes, who you really were.
Yeah. And, you know, I have to tell you about in high school, too, and this, you know, even in that, when I look back, you know, and I would say this to your listeners, it takes years sometimes to process some of these feelings. And I look back and say those two injuries are the best things that ever happened to me in my life. When I broke my collarbone in high school, I'll never forget, you know, I had three brothers and we were very competitive with each other. We all wanted to be better than the other. So we had this love for each other, but there was this fire that, you know, we had to be better than the other. And I'll never forget when I got hurt, all of my friends had come to visit me. And I remember hearing my family downstairs in the living room crying, my mother, my father, and my brothers. And I realized how much they loved me and how much they cared that my dream had been shattered. But my father always had priests in our home, which I was blessed for that. Always the parish priest was my dad's best friend. And Father Darty ate with us every Tuesday night. And his sister, Sister John Bertram's, she sent me a quote and I put it over my bed and I refer to it every day. Each sorrow is a shadow sweet that tells how near Christ's nailed feet are walking by thy side. And anytime I've hit adversity in my life or disappointment, I think that I'm blessed to feel just a portion of what Christ felt, you know, when he sacrificed and what he went through. So in retrospect, Those were all great things for me, having those injuries and learning from those experiences.
Amazing. Great, great testimony. And listeners, as much as you've been hearing all about the sports side of Frank, he has been even more devoted to his Catholic faith throughout his life, despite the demands on his time from his various coaching endeavors. But before I have him share more of his faith walk with us, I want to share with you why it's so beneficial to tap the subscribe button, which again is free of charge, on whatever podcast app you listen to Catholic Sports Radio on. Last week, Sunday, the Catholic Sports Radio website went down. I found out that it got hacked, no doubt Satan's work. And so on Monday, when episode 76 came out, you couldn't go to the website to hear it. But it was still on all the usual podcast platforms on time. So while the good news is that the website was able to be recovered and put back online, a bunch of work had to be done to clean out all the malware that had, I'll call it, infected the website. And I had to come up with $200 out of my pocket to pay for all that work. So when you hear me talk each week about supporting this ministry and how I'm a one-man operation taking this all on by myself and having to pay for expenses related to Catholic Sports Radio because I don't have sponsors and I don't get a paycheck for doing this, that is another example of how and where your donations help. As I've said before, if you enjoy this show and if you find value in what I put into it and you're enjoying Catholic Sports Radio and it's helping in your faith life, I would be most grateful if you could visit CatholicSportsRadio.net and use the Donate to CSR button so that you can contribute securely online in whatever amount you wish. No contribution is too big. No contribution is too small. You can also send a check or money order instead via U.S. mail. Just get in touch with me through the contact page on the website or through social media, and I will write you back personally since there's no one helping me, and I'll give you an address that you can send it to instead of putting credit card information online. Anything helps and is appreciated, and your contribution also tells me that you believe in and enjoy Catholic Sports Radio, and it helps me keep this ministry going. So please pray about it and know that I do truly appreciate your support. Frank, I mentioned back in the intro that you were inducted into the Sports Faith International Hall of Fame. In your speech at that event, you said, quote, "To the teachers and coaches assembled here, we have been called to the highest calling to mold and mentor young boys and girls who respectfully call us a coach. This is not a job, it is a ministry," end quote. Just elaborate on that, if you would.
Again, I go back to the influences, you know, that I have had on my life and people that have mentored and modeled me. And I think one of the greatest was Eric Parsegian. I mean, the impact that he had on my life, because not only was he a mentor, he was a model. And I think that's our duty, you know, in our ministries, is not only to say the words — anybody can say words — but to live the words is most important. And Coach Parsegian, you know, I remember in the Orange Bowl in 1972, we lost to Nebraska 40-6. It was one of the worst losses in Notre Dame history. And Coach walked in the locker room and he said, "Boys," he said, "gentlemen, I want you to remember this as long as you live. Adversity has the effect of eliciting talents which under prosperous conditions might have remained dormant." And he walked out of the room, leaving us to kind of figure out what those words meant, right? And that became our battle cry. Adversity has the effect of eliciting talents which under prosperous conditions might have remained dormant. And that team bonded together from that 8-3 year, which was a very mediocre year for Notre Dame at that time. We rallied from that. We worked together. We bonded. We came back the next year. We went 11-0. We won the national championship. But the real amazing thing about the story and why I've been so blessed that God steered me to Notre Dame to play under a mentor like him, years later, in 1994, I think it was, my father told me to watch 60 Minutes. There was a profile on Coach Parsegian. And I asked him what it was about, and he said, "No, just watch it." So I watched the show, and it was about Coach Parsegian's oldest grandchild had contracted this. He was actually having some coordination problems on the playground, and they couldn't figure out what was wrong. They sent him to some specialists. They found out that he had Niemann-Pick type C syndrome. It's a neurological disease that attacks the it doesn't process cholesterol, and it's a debilitating disease, and there's no cure for it. So Coach, rather than wallow in that despair, decided to do something about it. And unfortunately, that disease was a genetic disease. So he had to test all five of his grandchildren, or four of them, and three of them had it.
Oh, boy.
And so imagine getting news you're going to lose your three grandchildren. And Coach decided to leave the broadcast booth. He went out and he started the Ira Parseghian Medical Foundation to raise funds for this disease that only had one lab in the world researching it. There was two labs in the entire world researching it. And I went to a fundraising event and I saw Coach and he told me the tragic story. And as he was telling me this, he said, I can't save my grandchildren, but I'm going to dedicate my life that not one parent, no grandparent will ever go through what we are going through. I said, kind of like adversity has the effect of eliciting talents, which under prosperous conditions might have remained dormant. He lit up. He said, I taught somebody something. I said, if you ever knew, I mean, everything I am, you know, as a coach and as a mentor and try to be as a youth minister really was based on the lessons I learned from him and not only speaking words, but modeling them for other people. So I think that's what we our obligation as teachers, educators. We're all teachers. We're all coaches, whether we're parenting or whether we're a friend. You know, we're always modeling the right way to act.
Beautifully said. Wow. Tell the audience also about your Excel basketball camps, which are not just somewhere that kids go to sharpen their shooting and passing and ball handling skills, by the way.
Well, you know, that's another interesting story in that I was mentored by a coach that changed my life. When I was 15 years old, I was at a basketball camp in Pennsylvania, and I met this coach named Stu Aberdeen. And Coach Aberdeen really was a coach at the University of Tennessee. And he came to our camp and he gave this incredible speech about the winning edge. And it was really based on faith, saying that, you know, there's 2,000 kids in the country that I want to recruit. I'm only going to recruit four of those kids. How do you separate yourself? He talked about going to church. He talked about not using foul language, about respecting your parents. And every time he said you do the right thing, you are eliminating the pool around you. So his whole philosophy was on modeling the right behavior. And so I embraced that and tried to live that at 15 years old when he really made sense to me. Flat, if you fast forward into the late 1970s, I'm out on a business trip to Hawaii. I pick up the San Francisco Examiner and I see a little paragraph that Coach Stu Aberdeen died of a massive heart attack. He was the head coach at Marshall University, just 43 years old. I was devastated. Called my wife. I said, Stu Aberdeen died. She knew the effect he had on me. And I was so distraught that he received a little paragraph. This man who was a life changer, this was it. I went to bed that night and I swear I dreamt my camp right down to the logo. And I called my brother Jerry and I said, I'm going to start a camp to promote Coach Aberdeen and keep his message alive. And my brother was coaching high school at the time. He said, you're not even coaching. I was coaching youth basketball. And I said, well, I'm doing this. You know, the first year I had 37 kids in the camp and it's been sold out for the last 39, 40 years because of, you know, the whole philosophy of what we embody. And the lesson I learned from that was the success of any venture will be determined by the spirit in which it was entered. I didn't go into the camp business to create a business. I didn't go into it to make money. I went in it to honor somebody and to promote his lessons to kids. And I firmly believe that that's why the camp has been so successful, because it's all about keeping the message of someone that changed my life.
Yeah. And by the way, listeners, there's a lot of hats that Frank is wearing. In addition to your job at the University of San Francisco, you're also involved with a CYO league in your area.
Yep. So I moved to California in 75, and I think it was the summer of 76, actually. And I tried to coach CYO basketball, and they were filled. They didn't have room for me. And then they called me a week later and said, we do have some kids. He said, they are not a very talented group of kids, but, you know, you're welcome to take them on. And I said, I'll take them on. And I did. And that started a love affair with CYO basketball. So I've been doing that for 44 years. Started as a coach, and then I was an athletic director at St. Agnes Parish. And then I was a vice president of the league for about 20 years, and I've recently become the president of the East Diablo League, which serves 10 parishes. And we are in the process of reevaluating our whole league, and that we are really emphasizing prayer and sportsmanship and doing things the right way within our own parishes. And we've gotten a great reaction from the other athletic directors. So I think we're really keeping that moving, because, you know, there's a lot of programs out there, but CYO is different. It's about Christ. It's about we're all in this together, and we're trying to promote that with our leagues.
Fantastic. Well, I looked at the list of groups that you've been a keynote speaker for, and again, so many that are Catholic-based. My guess, though, is that they're booking you because of all your sports stories, but you're probably ending up going and telling them the importance in faith in our lives, just like I'm doing with Catholic Sports Radio, yes?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's one of my favorite things to do. I love speaking. I love talking to youth groups. I'll talk to anybody. You know, I just really, it's my passion to go out and talk to kids and adults. You know, I've talked to many Catholic Knights of Columbus groups and SIRS groups, and I just really enjoy getting out and sharing stories. And all the stories point, yeah, they really do. They point to something, and they don't point there intentionally. They point there because they're real. You know, that's what really happened, you know, and I'll sort of wrap my Notre Dame experience up, because another great lesson. I told you about my bitterness, how I was angry, you know, felt like I got cheated, that God had let me down when I was so loyal to him, you know, and it took me months to get over that. And I'll tell you when I got over it, I got a letter from my best friend, Alan Lesnowich. His mother wrote me a letter, and she said, you know, they used to call me the heartbreak kid, because I always never got a break, you know, every time I'd get to there. And she wrote me this letter, and she said, you know, it was agonizing to watch your career. You know, you were all American. You wanted to go to Notre Dame, and you separate your, you know, you break your clavicle in the first game. Then you wait 4 years. You're patient. You wait for your turn, and you get your dream, and then you separated your shoulder. She said, you just never got a break, you know. And I wrote back to her, and I said, you know, I got every break you could ever imagine, because I never understood why I was driven to be what I wanted to be. And it was for all the wrong reasons. I wanted to be a pro athlete. I wanted the glory. I wanted the adulation. You know, I wanted all the things that went with it. I wanted to please my parents. You know, I wanted to please my friends. In fact, that's probably why I went to Notre Dame, right? And yet I told her the story that I was running the stadium steps one day. I did it every day after my injury. And Notre Dame has 36 gates, used to be 36 gates, 60 steps up. I know it because I did it every day. 60 steps up, run over, down 60, run over, up 60. Did this, you know, every day. It was very painful. And one of the last times I did it was in August. And I had 5 gates to go, and I was dead tired. I couldn't take one more step. And I was going to quit for the first time. And I kept saying, don't quit. You've never quit before. And then I said, what's the difference? I got to stop. I'm tired. And I looked to the entrance to the stadium, and there was a couple dropping off their child to Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. I had my jersey on with number 12 and my name on the back. And I said, they know I'm the starting quarterback.
Yeah.
I got a burst of adrenaline, and I sprinted those 5 gates, ran over, introduced myself, welcomed their son to Notre Dame. And I told Mrs. Lesnowich in my letter that it was at that point that I realized the beauty of sport is the man who runs the stadium steps when the seats are empty. Anyone can run them when they're full. When I was dead tired. When I saw somebody, I was able to run. So it's not playing for people. It's the beauty of being alone in that stadium, running those steps every single day, that really was the definition of my experience at Notre Dame. So again, it took me that to kind of figure out that God wasn't cheating me. God was giving me all these different lessons, and it took time for me to heal and to absorb those. And I am so committed to them and so blessed that I have them, that I've spent my lifetime trying to share them with other people through my camps, through my ministry of CYO, and through speaking.
Well, and as much as we should and we do get enjoyment being in community with one another at church, or before all the pandemic hit, going to a Christian concert or things like that, isn't there beauty in those quiet moments when it is just us and God, and you're so close to him because there is no one else around and you are so focused on him? So that's what was happening to you there, and praise God that he was able to make that impression on you, that you stuck around for and you persevered in your faith to be open to hearing that from him.
And you think about the pandemic. I mean, are we using that opportunity, you know, to improve ourselves? You know, find something that you want to improve upon, or self-reflect, or develop a different relationship or a better relationship, you know, with Christ. Because this is a time to do that. We've never had less distractions, and we really need to make sure that we are moving towards improving ourselves and make sure that something positive comes out of this adversity, as my old mentor would say.
And how? Yeah. We're about out of time. Final question. In your current role at the University of San Francisco, are you able to find opportunities for fellowship with student athletes, being that you're not on the front line with them as a basketball coach anymore?
Yeah. So I went there as a basketball coach. I was the associate head coach there for a year. Loved it. Loved working with the kids. Loved the recruiting and getting out and spreading the word about the University of San Francisco. And then I was asked to stay on in an athletic administration. I absolutely love it. I don't know if I've ever felt a better connection. I love the school. I really love what they stand for with the Jesuit tradition. And so, you know, we are trying every day, we're trying to reach kids, you know, through our work with kids and with coaches in developing a culture of doing things correctly. Obviously, here's what I always say. We know it works in America. It's just frustrating that nobody wants to do it anymore. You know, and so when you look at the Jesuit tradition, they know it works. It's worked for many, many years. And so I think we're just fortunate to have that as the overall base of what we do. And the university is really wonderful in embracing people, all peoples, and trying to provide what's best and serve our students and our community as best as possible.
Outstanding. Outstanding. Frank, so great to talk to you. God bless you. Thank you for being on Catholic Sports Radio. This was wonderful.
Thank you, Bruce. It's been a pleasure to be here. I appreciate you very much.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And listeners, since we do have a coach on this week's episode, we will close with a prayer for coaches. So let's do that together as always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I'll start with a passage from 1 Corinthians, which says, "But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Lord, we all want to win. Above the desire to win, teach us to remember our victories toward godly living as we learn to obey you and your word daily. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks so much for listening. This is Catholic Sports Radio. Find more at catholicsportsradio.net, as well as on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. It is at Cath Sports Radio on all those, C-A-T-H, at Cath Sports Radio. I'm Bruce Wozniak, and remember, it's not whether you win or lose, it's that it's Jesus that you always choose.